we all know Francois from Ilria, 3 years in Nice, Ecole Normale, the premier university in France, and now in UT Austin. Actually, let me say something. I've known him for obviously many, many years, but I remember today how I first came across his name, actually. So it must have been 1986 or 7. And you had written the first book, your first book, which was a Springer lecture notes on ergodic point processes.
Oh, yeah.
Right?
Yeah, yeah.
And you had sent a copy of it. Perhaps it was not a book yet, but it was notes, and it was sitting on Zahn's desk. And I walked into his office. I said, "What is this?" He said, "Oh, someone called Francois Bazzelli had written it and so on." I picked it up, I started looking through it, and then you locked me into this point of view for the next many, many years. So thank you for that, and I give you Francois without any further ado.
Okay, so thank you for these nice words, Nick. So so I would like to start with a few words on how I started interacting with Jean. And we had a small working group in France, and there was Pierre Brémaud, Jacques Neveu, and a few others. And it was in the late 70s, 1970s, and early 80s. And we were looking at these very beautiful things coming from Berkeley. And I remember the CMU rule paper with Jean Pravin, and so we were studying these things, and we were studying, and so I didn't know at that time, but it was the start of a very fruitful interactions, and with Jean, we have several joint papers, and with all his, not only students, I worked a lot with Nick, with Takis, but also relatives, because we have papers with Kostas, and we have a very strong collaboration with Venkat, and okay, so lots of interaction, and that's really great, and it started in the at that time, and I'm very grateful for that. One thing, since you mentioned Ecole Normale, this comes to my mind right now, to give you another dimension of these interactions. We have this tradition at Ecole Normale to invite scholars to convince students to come to one field rather than doing, at that time in mathematics, students would either do classification of finite groups or do algebraic geometry. And so, and you remember there was the mathematician that invited Alain Cohn, and I'd invited Jean Valrand. We gave the lecture after Alain Cohn, or before, I don't remember. And so some of the students decided to go to something else than algebraic geometry, and thanks to Jean, and this was a generation of Alexandre Proutière, Augustin Chantreau, who was in math and came. So thanks, Jean, for the very strong influence that you had also, not only in Berkeley, but in France. Okay, very good. So let's move to. So I decided to pick a topic on queuing, because it started with queuing, and also on wireless. So I mean, it's a joint work with Sergei Foss and a PhD student. I will give the details. And so it started with a wireless spatial birth and death process. So there is a wireless aspect, a stochastic geometry of point process dimension, and the queuing thing, which is okay. Fair enough. So I'll start with the background and motivation. I'll start with the thing we did with Abhishek Sankararaman. So on the compact and the point processing, and I'll tell you then on what we are currently doing with Sergei and Abhishek. And so the current version was posted a few weeks ago. So in the first thing, I will describe the stability issues, the clustering properties of point processes, and a few quantitative results. And I'll go then to the non-compact state space case, where we have simplified the problem. where I will discuss techniques which Nick alluded to, like coupling from the past and Lorentz-type techniques that we investigated lately. Okay, so it's pretty much ongoing work for the second part. So what are the motivations? So as I mentioned, so I've been working a lot on stochastic geometry to look at these wireless problems. But you have either this viewpoint that you take the geometry viewpoint and look at interactions of objects and take a static snapshot of a wireless network, and then you can look at what the typical guy gets in terms of its Shannon rate or something of this type. Or if there is motion, it is a static thing where all stations would be active. But if you want to mix that with flow-based queuing, with churn, with join and leave, then basically there are other techniques. But what the talk I'm going to, the presentation I make here is to try to marry these two things, right? To have in the stochastic geometry dynamics, which is queuing dynamics. So of course, I mean, this, there are lots of interesting controlled wireless and sorts of purely join and leave papers for representing or trying to represent wireless, like the work of Bonald and Proutier. But I will make the differences during the talk. Okay, so that's the context. So let's look first at the point process viewpoint. So the setting would be a problem like the Gupta-Kumar. There is a slight difference because, I mean, this will be dipoles, you will see in a second. But this, it belongs to this ad hoc D2D networks, right? And so everything will be Markov, Poisson exponential, and mathematics there will be point process techniques and fluid techniques. Okay, so here is an artist picture of the so dipoles fall as a Poisson rain from the sky. A dipole has a transmitter at one end and a receiver at the other end. This dipole has a link. It's a certain number of packets to transmit, right? Okay, and so the birth of these dipoles. Think of the dipoles to be small to make things simple. So the birth will be a Poisson rain. So period time and space, this guy fall. And once a configuration is formed, you have to look in the current state as the interference. Okay, and you will deplete. So this is the packet to be, so it's an exponential number of bits to be transmitted. So you look at if you have a receiver, right, for this dipole, you look at the Shannon rate this guy would get. You have some bandwidth. There is a mean number of bits for this to be transmitted. So you would look at the signal there, at the noise, and you treat interference as noise to make things simple. And you would deplete the dipoles. At this rate, which is a function of the geometry, okay? And you see something interesting and which has not, in a sense, been looked at in the stochastic geometry setting. So if you would have a Poisson point process in the first place for the dipoles, then you could compute the statistics of this interference by using a shot noise. But what happens is that those guys who have a stronger interference, they will be depleted more slowly. And then we accumulate, whereas in other areas where it goes faster, it will be way better. And you see that you cannot disentangle geometry and dynamics, okay? And that's the thing we started looking at. So let's make it simple. So we looked with Abhishek at the case of a torus. Links arrive according to this Poisson rain, so lambda dx dt on this torus. As I said, each dipole has an exponential file size with mean L bits to transmit. And the point exists, after the file is transmitted, right? And so the state space, since you're on a compact, will be a point configuration. So you have a Markov chain on point processes on a finite set. Okay, and here is the sort of formalization of what I said. So you look at the interference seen at point X, okay, or receiver of dipole X, which will be a function of the current configuration, right? So L is the attenuation function, the path-loss function. And as I said, I will take, so you have a spatial birth and death process where the death rate is a function of the Shannon rate that you would get if you would consider that interference is treated as noise, right? Okay, and so you see the rate is a function of the interference, and the interference is a function of the geometry, and the question is how to analyze that. Okay, so you have a birth and death master equation. So if you would know the history of this phi u point process, you would integrate the rate, look at the first time after birth where you have obtained the number of bits that you need, and that would give you your departure time, right? And actually, the equation that we will solve is this one, but it's not the right way of looking at it, right? Okay, fair enough. So that's the problem. Okay. And you see, I mean, it's very different from what people have done when they look at these flow-based ideas for wireless, right? Because there is not this entanglement between geometry and dynamic, okay? Fair enough. So questions, does there exist on a compact first a stationary regime? And second, I mean, what is this regime? I mean, what is in steady state? So first, does it clog? I mean, I started telling you that, I mean, things accumulate, right? So, and if there is an accumulation, a cluster, then things get worse. So could it work, right? And okay, so that's the result. Yes, it can. So let's call A the integral over the torus of the L function. And so the torus is just to make things compact and to have a nice group where you can work out Palm calculus and this type of things. And the theorem says that if you look at this integral, so if lambda exceeds b over log 2 LA, L is the mean length, then phi t admits no stationary regime. But if lambda is less than this constant, and there are technical conditions at this stage, the function L over R is bounded and monotone, then phi of t admits a unique stationary regime. Okay, so this spatial birth and death process has a stability condition which is triggered and completely determined by this integral. Okay. So the necessary condition comes from Palm calculus and stochastic intensities as the Papangelou formula for that. I got a good introduction for this topic with Nick. And the sufficient condition is quite interesting, comes from a fluid limit. And this type of things, I will explain a bit why it comes from, right? So the why it happens. But okay, but the corollary is that if you take the, I would say, path-loss function, which is in many papers on wireless, with the singularity at the origin, then you are dead. It will never be stable. If you take bounded ones, you have a chance, right? And this is the condition. Okay, that's the first result. Here is a qualitative result. This qualitative result is the one I alluded to. The point process in steady state will be clustered. And I will explain what it means. And that's the definition that I will take for clustering. I will say phi for the point process is clustered is for all bounded positive non-increasing function f. I look at the shot noise created by the configuration. And so I am on a structure which I have a nice group of transformation. So think of the Euclidean plane in the translations if you would be in the second part. The Palm expectation of the shot noise exceeds that of the stationary expectation, right? So it means a typical point, if I make measurements from a point which is present, a dipole which is present or the receiver, I see nearby more points. This is the biasing created by Palm, than if I take a typical locus in the Euclidean space. Okay, and so the theorem is that for any functions, held in the settings that I gave, the steady state point process when it exists is clustered in that sense. And it follows from Palm calculus and the FKG inequality. Okay, so the second thing is about moving to the questions of evaluation of the steady state now. So this is this clustering. You see, I mean, so it's point process pictures. You see, it's very different from what would be a Poisson point process, right? Okay, so let me go fast on the quantitative result because I want to move to the second part. We have two heuristics. The first one is a sort of replica method from physical statistics, which pretends that you have a Poisson point process with a given intensity beta f. Okay, so which consists in neglecting the Palm bias that I said, right? And the second one is a second order heuristic, beta s, which is based on an approximation for the second order moment measure and a sort of cavity method for the approximating the dynamics. So perhaps I won't go very much into that. So everything is based on Palm calculus. So, and so for instance, this would be the rate conservation law, right? So that's the number of bits that arrive per unit time and space. And that's, if I would know beta, the intensity of the stationary point process, this would be the depletion rate in terms of bits, where you see the chance to see a point in dx times the Palm expectation if there's a point of the rate that this fellow gets, right? So that's the idea of the Poisson heuristic. The Poisson heuristic, you say, let's remove that, then work out classical tools of Poisson geometry to compute the characteristics of this, and then you get a nice expression for beta. And this is a Poisson heuristic, which can be seen as a sort of replica, replica method in statistical physics. This heuristic is tight in heavy and light traffic. So the second order heuristic, I will skip it. It's a cavity method. So it is based on a rate conservation for the second order moment measure and not the first one, which tells you the chance to see a point at x and a point at y, right? Okay. So let me move to the second part, which is the infinite domain case. So the aim is to extend this type of dynamics on the whole of R2. We are not yet there, but close. And with Sergei and Abhishek, we decided to look at something which is the simplest thing which is meaningful, which would be a discrete queuing system on a grid, which features and keeps the essence of what we have, right? And here the tools are interacting particle systems, coupling from the past, and again the Palm. Ah, that's the that's so again the artist's viewpoint of what it is. So okay, so this cut is the Euclidean plane, and here are the cues, right? So now by dipoles, I have discretized space into small boxes. You see these small boxes, and dipoles accumulate. Right? Think of these dipoles to be very small. So here you see there are three dipoles in this queue. There is one in that neighboring queue, and this one has two, this one has four, and so forth, right? Okay. And so you see, I mean, they are fed by this Poisson rain of dipoles, and the interference, for instance, at this, that a typical dipole sees here, I will create a processor sharing queue or a network of processor sharing queue where the rate in that queue is given like x over I, so it processor sharing. So if I have x customers here, it will be x times something. And I've linearized the Shannon thing. So I'm in the low SNR regime. and I would look at what this guy gets. So he is self-interfering with a coefficient A naught, which would be like the earlier L function with his own buddies in the same queue. And for this guy, for instance, if I have a function that only puts mass on the neighboring queues, you would have an A1 times this number, plus A1 times the green number, plus the yellow, plus the red, okay? So I'm here saying that the rate is the sum of the rates, which are the Shannon rate, linearized, because I say the interference is high, and therefore the log of 1 plus 1 over I would be like 1 over I, okay? Okay, so so QI now in this particle system has state xi of t at time t. It's an integer, the number of dipoles sitting there. Arrivals are independent Poisson. And I give an interference function, which is like now a discrete version of the L function earlier, and, which I take non-negative, symmetric, and irreducible. So I will explain what irreducible is. But let's say it has a good, for instance, full support, right? And decreasing fast enough to infinity, you will need integrability conditions, right? And then the Jean-type model would be feature a generalized processor sharing collection of Qs where the rate in QI is xi of t at time t times the rate that an individual gets, which is this thing. Okay? Fair enough. Theorem. If lambda is less than 1 over the integral of the A function, so you recognize the same thing, then the network is stable in the sense that if you start the system empty at time zero, there is weak convergence of the state of any finite set of Qs when t goes to infinity. Okay. This weak limit is the minimal stationary regime. Everything will be, with every other solution, there may be other, will be bigger stochastically. Okay, and this condition is sharp. At least we are sure of it, and we proved it in some special cases. And here comes the amazing thing. This object, which is infinite dimensional, non-reversible, non-asymptotically independent, and queuing system, admits a closed form for the mean number of dipoles that are waiting in the typical queue. Everything is symmetrical, and this is the expression for the mean value of the number of dipoles in, say, the blue queue at the center, right? But of course, everything is invariant by translation there, and so this is and the coordinates xi are positively correlated, associated, which is the analog of clustering. So the theorem which gives the and so this is was expected. What was surprising is that, and it only works with the linearization of the log. Uniqueness, there is a theorem which says that this minimal solution is the only possible stationary regime with finite second moments and a sufficient condition. Let's say if lambda is less than 2/3 of the capacity condition, then you are sure that there is a unique regime, because this implies that there are second moments, and if there are second moments, there is a unique stationary regime with second moments. Of course, I mean, you are in the particle system framework, so you're not in the Markov framework anymore. So in the Markov framework, if it's irreducible, you have a unique solution. There, it's not the case. Okay, more about uniqueness. So we have a theorem that says that if lambda is in this region, which is a bit more than stable, then any initial condition which is bounded by a constant above, so you have this infinite domain, and you take something that fluctuates but bounded above, is in the domain of attraction of this minimal solution. But, and we have examples of bad initial conditions. Say, for instance, if you take IID initial conditions on Z, they need heavy tails, right? Then this guy converges almost surely to infinity. So really, I mean, lots of things can happen in the infinite domain. Okay, so summary. We have tried to have a new representation of this space-time interaction in wireless networks, which I think have not been looked at. So people have looked at geometry on one side, people have looked at cues, but without geometry in a sense. here the queues build the geometry and the geometry build the queues. So it's okay. So it's we believe that it's interesting model for because it will be a generative model for clustering, and you know that some bodies we say that this should be taken in a simulation standard. There is a new notion of dynamic capacity which involves both queuing and information theoretic. Poor man's information theoretic, there is no yet fancy thing, but we could look at more fancy not treating interference as noise and look at interference cancellation of things like that, or MAC channels, right? Or even interference channels. Very good. And I insist on this thing, which is surprising to us because we would like to try to extend it, that you find an object. So this object is not at all a mean field limit where you would see independence asymptotically. If you think of it as a limit of a large network, queues go on interacting very strongly in even in the infinite case, right? Neighboring queues, they share interference, which is local. So it's fundamentally different from mean field. And yet, it's easy to see, so it's not reversible, not Gibbs in any good sense. And yet, first moment is in closed form. Okay, so if one of you can explain why, I would be happy. Thanks, Jean. As I say in French here, almost 40 years of interaction, and looking forward for the next 40 years of interaction.
Any comments on the case where your dipoles might have a finite length?
The framework, the Markov framework, will be a bit more, but it doesn't change fundamentally, right? So yeah, so it's for instance, in the first paper with Abhishek, we say that we can do it, right? But we did not do it because it's boring. But there is no fundamental difficulty, right? So it just changes the signal strength, right? And but the fact that in areas where there will be one guy whose receiver is surrounded by transmitters which are bad configuration of this type will persist, and this clustering will have a different geometry, but it will persist, and the same phenomena. So the notion of distance, if you want, of clustering is a bit different, right? So two guys, if one is like this, one is like that, this will be persist because, you create big interference from one to the other and dually. So you have to change a little bit the distance, but the fundamentals will be the same.
I wonder if there is a nice multi-hopping kind of routing problem in your setup, because you don't want to use sort of good routes too much, risk depleting some of the dipoles. So there might be an interesting routing problem in multi-hopping.
Yeah, that would be very interesting. But you see, I think this is the step to solve the simplest problem. The simplest problem has no routing. You just want to really check whether you can treat the entanglement of geometry and wireless dynamics in an exact way. And I think there is no thing simpler than that. Okay? So there is your question opens lots of things to do, right? So you can start introducing information theory in a serious way, multi-user information theory. You can start introducing scheduling in a serious way. Routing in the same way. We would have join and leave and things of this type. If you would have longer, a path and things of this type. So the first step must be this one. Because if you can't solve this one, and you see, if you are not in the low SNR, I have only a hierarchy of conservation equations for the moment measures to try to understand the clustering. But no exact solution. I have no idea, right? So we are not yet, and we are far from understanding even this simple case. And so if you start
adding, say, multi-hop routing and things that it will be even more complex, and so I think it's too early.
What's your thinking on if the nodes, if there's mobility? If there's interaction, but there's also mobility.
Yeah, that would be very interesting. Random mobility might help because, I mean, so if you have random mobility, you might, sort of Brownian motion or something like that, right? You will kill these aggregates. Aggregates are very bad, right? And so aggregates will kill the system if we take the r to the minus alpha rate Pastor's function, right? So this clogging, so and we see it in simulation and we proved it, right? This clogging, that these clusters lead to self-reinforcement of bad events, are just making this system. But so if you have a diffusive force, then perhaps you can improve the stability and have some conditions which would... So that's a beautiful question, but I don't know the answer.
Can you get any large deviation kind of property if you want to find how fast those things can build up?
So what you ask is, can you get properties on second order moment measure, yeah, right? Because first order moment measure, so and the story goes like that. If you don't linearize, right, to understand, you have, like in some of these UV problem, you have... to get the first moment, you need the second moment measure. To find the second moment measure, you need the third moment measure. And so what we do at each step is we break, so we say the third moment measure is the second moment measure, and you factorize, right? And then you get a fixed point, right? But so to understand how things build up geometrically, you need to understand moment measures of higher order. And it's a format, it's a very difficult thing. We have... sort of ways of doing it. And these are these heuristics that I gave. But we have we don't know whether these things converge and how to do the thing in a systematic way. But that's what we try to do. So if you ask about, I mean, how it builds now, if it is unstable, it's a bit different thing. So in the unstable case, we have not looked at that. We more look at in the stable case how aggregates. What is the nature of the aggregates?
Okay, let's thank.